annual showing of hourly production of arsenic and old lace. So, as I was able to do this as a part of my senior project, there are a few people I'd like to give thanks to. First off, Nani Phillips, who mentored me through this process. Mike Cass for being able to perform such a wonderful show. My crew for keeping things from falling apart. And I'd also like to thank the LCTC, or the Lake County Theater Company, for giving me the opportunity to put on such a wonderful production in the first place. So, a couple of quick notes. First off, there's only one intermission, however, after that, there are a few times the curtains will close. That's not like anything to get up for. Okay, so there is a, for the beginning auditions, it's called Fisher School. It's really the Kanakti Academic Center.
Sorry.
So with Allie, it doesn't give her a, like a last name, it's Allie Miller.
Sorry.
Alright, so also, raffle tickets, they'll count for, well, they won't count for like any other shows after this, but they're $1 and they're out there, you get them during intermission. And with playbills, never mind, that doesn't seem to be okay, so turn off phones, no flash photography, and thank you for coming. I mean, seriously, thank you all. I hope it's a great show. In fact, it's going to be. It's going to be a lovely show. Without further ado, Arsenic and Old Lace.
Sunday. It really is wonderful, Dr. Harper. In just two short years, you've taken on the spirit of Brooklyn. Why, that's very gratifying, Miss Brewster. You see, living here, next to the church all our lives, we've seen so many ministers come and go. The spirit of Brooklyn, we always say, is friendliness, and your sermons are not so much sermons as friendly talks.
Personally, I've always enjoyed my conversations with Cardinal Gibbons, or have I met him yet?
No, dear, not yet. Oh, were the biscuits good?
Bully.
Oh, won't you try another biscuit, Dr. Harper?
No, thank you. I'm afraid I'll have no appetite for dinner now. I always eat too many of your biscuits just to try the lovely jam.
But you haven't tried it with the quince. We always put just a little apple in to take the tartness out.
No, thank you.
We'll send you over a jar.
Keep it here so I can be sure of having your biscuits with it when I come over.
I do hope they don't make us use that imitation flour again. I mean, with this war trouble, it may not be very charitable of me, but I've almost come to the conclusion that this Mr. Hitler isn't a Christian.
If only Europe were on another planet.
Europe?
Yes.
Well, point your gun the other way.
Gun, and that's
to the west. There's your danger. There's your enemy, Japan.
Why, yes, of course.
And that's Hitty, darling.
No, Aunt Abby. Not so much talk about Europe, and more about the canal.
Well, let's not talk about the war. Oh, won't you have another cup of tea, dear?
No, thank you, Aunt Abby.
And Dr. Harper?
No, thank you. I must admit, Miss Abby, war and violence seem far removed from these surroundings.
It is peaceful here, isn't it?
Yes, peaceful. All the virtues of another day here in this lovely home. The gentle virtues that went out with good manners, candlelight, and low taxes.
It's one of the oldest houses in Brooklyn. It's just as it was when Grandfather Brewster built and furnished it. Except for the electricity, and we used that only as little as possible. It was Mortimer who persuaded us to put it in.
Yes, I can understand that. Your nephew Mortimer seems to live only by electric light.
The poor boy, he has to work so late. Oh, I understand he's taking Elaine with him to the theater tonight. Teddy, your brother Mortimer will be here a little bit later.
Delighted, yes.
We're so happy it's Elaine Mortimer takes to the theater with him.
Well, it is a new experience for me to wait up until 3 o'clock in the morning to have my daughter brought home to me.
Oh, Dr. Harper, I hope you don't disapprove of Mortimer.
Well,
feel so guilty if you did. Sister Martha and I, since it was here in our home that your daughter met Mortimer.
Yes, and so I'll say immediately that I believe Mortimer himself to be quite a worthy gentleman. But I have also been watching the growing intimacy between your nephew Mortimer and my daughter with some trepidation. And for one reason, Miss Abby.
You mean his stomach, Dr. Harper?
His stomach?
His dyspepsia. He's bothered with so the poor boy.
No, I'll be frank with you. It's his unfortunate connection to the theater.
The theater? No, you see, Dr. Harper, Mortimer writes for a New York newspaper.
Yes, but I do not doubt what some of them do develop an interest in it.
Well, not Mortimer. You need have no fear of that. Why, Mortimer hates the theater.
Really?
Oh, yes. Mortimer writes terrible things about the theater. But you can't blame him, the poor boy. He was so happy writing about real estate, which he really did know something about. And they just gave him this awful night position.
My, my. That's terrible.
Yes. But as he says, the theater can't last much longer anyway. And in the meantime, it's a living. Yes, I think perhaps if we give the theater a couple more years, it will just... Oh, no, thank you, dear. I'll get it. Hello, Mr. Brophy.
Hello, Miss Brewster.
How are you, Mr. Clyde?
Hello, Miss Brewster.
What news have you brought me?
Garner, we have nothing to report.
Splendid, thank you, gentlemen. At ease.
You two know Dr. Harper?
Oh, sure. Hello, Dr. Harper.
We've come for the toys for the Christmas fund.
Oh, yes.
That is a splendid work you men do, fixing up old discarded toys to give poor children a happier Christmas.
It gives us something to do when we've got a sitter out at the station. You get bored playing cards, and then you start cleaning your gun, and next thing you know, you shot yourself in the foot.
Well, Teddy, go upstairs to your Aunt Martha's room and bring down that big box of toys. Well, come, gentlemen, sit down. Do sit down. How is Mrs. Brophy today? Mrs. Brophy has been quite ill, Dr. Harper.
Pneumonia. I'm sorry to hear that.
Charge!
Oh, she's doing better now. She's a little weak still.
Oh.
Well, I'll just get you some beef broth to take to her.
Oh, don't bother, Miss Abby. You've done so much for her already.
Oh, we made it this morning. Martha and I, well, we've been taking to cooking things lately. She's taking some now to poor Mr. Banitsky. Please sit down, be comfortable. I won't be but a minute.
She really shouldn't go through all that trouble.
Listen, try and stop her or her sister from doing something nice. And for nothing. They don't even care how you go.
Yes, when I received my call to Brooklyn, my husband was very ill. When he died, and for months before, well, if I don't know what pure kindness and absolute generosity are, it's because I've known the Brewster sisters.
Garner, I promised you wouldn't do that anymore.
I have to call a cabin meeting to get ready for their supply.
He used to do that in the middle of the night. The neighbors dressed canvas. They're a little afraid of him anyway.
Why, he's quite harmless.
Suppose he does think he's Teddy Roosevelt. There's a lot worse you could think he was.
It's a damn shame. Nice family like this, hatching a cuckoo.
Well, his father, the old girl's brother, was some sort of genius, wasn't he? And their father, Teddy's grandfather. Seems to me I heard he was a little crazy, too.
Yeah, crazy. Crazy like a fox. He made $1 million.
Really? Here in Brooklyn?
Mm-hmm. Pat Madison. He was kind of a quack of some sort. You know, old Sergeant Edwards remembers him. He used the house here as some sort of clinic, tratting out on people.
Heard he used to make mistakes occasionally, too.
Yeah, but the department never bothered him much because he was pretty good on autopsies sometimes, especially poison cases.
Well, whatever he did left his daughters fixed for life. Thank God for that.
Not that they ever spent any of it on themselves.
Yes, I'm well acquainted with their charities.
You didn't know the tenth of it. When I was with the Missing Persons Bureau, we were trying to trace a man that we never did find. Do you know there's a renting agency that has this house down for us to furnish rooms? They don't rent rooms here, but you can bet anybody looking for a room goes away with a good meal and a few dollars in their pick.
It's just their way of digging up people to do some good to.
Oh, isn't this nice?
Good afternoon, Miss Brewster.
Good afternoon, Mr. Brophy, Dr. Harper, Mr. Klein.
How are you, Miss Brewster? We dropped in to get the Christmas toys.
Yes, Teddy's Army and Navy. They do wear out. They're all packed.
Oh, the Colonel's upstairs after them. It seems the captain has to okay it.
Yes, of course. How is Mrs. Brophy?
Oh, she's doing fine, ma'am. Your sister's off getting some soup for me to take to her.
Yes, we made it this morning. I just took some to a poor man who broke ever so many bones.
Oh, you're back, Martha. How is Mr. Banitsky?
It's quite serious, I'm afraid. They're going to amputate in the morning.
Oh, may we be present?
They said it was against the rules of the hospital.
Oh. Well, you couldn't be of any service. And you must spare yourself something.
I suppose.
Oh, here's the beef broth, Mr. Brophy. Be sure it's good and hot.
Yes, ma'am.
This will be fine. That O'Malley boy is nuts about soldiers.
This is General Miles. I've retired him. But what's this? You're gone?
Teddy, please.
The Oregon goes to Australia.
Now, Teddy.
I've given my word to fight in Bob Evans.
Teddy, put it back.
What's the difference what kid gets in? Bob Evans? Is he coming? We'll run along then. Thank you for your time.
No, not at all. Goodbye. Well, I must be getting home.
Oh, yes, Dr. Harper. Before you leave.
Charge! Charge the blockhouse!
The blockhouse?
The stairs are always San Juan Hill.
Have you ever tried to convince him that he isn't Teddy Roosevelt?
Oh, no. He's so happy being Teddy.
Once, a long time ago, remember, Martha? We thought that if he might be George Washington, it would be a good change for him.
But he just stayed under his bed for days and wouldn't be anybody.
And we'd so much rather he be Mr. Roosevelt than nobody. Well, if he's happy, and what's more important, you're happy, you will see that he signs these.
What are they?
Oh, Dr. Harper has made all the arrangements for Teddy to go to Happydale Sanitarium after we pass on.
Why should he sign them now?
Well, if the Lord may take either of you suddenly, and perhaps we couldn't get Teddy to commit himself, that would mean for an unpleasant legal procedure.
Yes, you see, Mr. Witherspoon understands that they're to be filed away until they're needed.
Oh, of course. Yes, well, I must be getting home, or Elaine will be after me.
Oh.
Yes, do give our love to Elaine.
Yes.
Oh, and Dr. Harper, please don't think too harshly of Mortimer, just because he's a dramatic critic. Somebody has to do those things.
Did you just have tea? Isn't it rather late?
Yes, and dinner's going to be late too.
So, why?
Teddy! Teddy, darling, come down here. Teddy, I have good news for you. You're going down to Panama to dig another lock for the canal.
Oh, bully, Miss Bully. I shall prepare at once for the journey.
Waldo is out.
Oh, yes, dear. I just couldn't wait for you. I didn't know when you'd be back, and Dr. Harper was coming.
Oh, I'll just go down to the cellar and see.
Oh, no, dear. There wasn't any time. And I was all alone.
Well,
Martha, just look in the window seat. Oh. Oh, it's Elaine. Come in, dear.
Good afternoon, Miss Addie. Good afternoon, Miss Martha. I thought Mother was here.
No, she just left a minute ago. Didn't you see her?
No, I took the shortcut to the cemetery.
Mortimer hasn't come yet?
No, dear. Oh, he asked me to meet him here. Do you mind if I wait?
Not at all.
Please sit down.
We really must speak to Mortimer about doing this to you.
Doing what?
Well, he was brought up to know better. When a young gentleman is taking out a young lady, he is to call for her at her house.
Oh, there's something about calling for a girl at a parsonage that discourages any man who doesn't embroider.
Still, he's done this too often. We're going to speak to him.
Oh, please don't. After young men whose idea of a nightlife is to take me to a prayer meeting, it's wonderful to go to the theater almost every night of my life.
It's comforting for us, too, if Mortimer has to see some of those plays he has to see. At least he's sitting next to a minister's daughter.
Oh, my goodness, Elaine. What you must think of us, not having tea put away by this time.
Oh, I'll help you when Mortimer comes. Mortimer should be here any minute now, darling.
Yes, Mother must have been surprised enough to find me at home.
I'd better run over and say goodnight to her. If Mortimer comes, tell him I'll be right back.
Of course.
Oh, hello, Mort.
Hello, Elaine. Hello, Aunt Martha.
Abby, Mortimer's here.
Were you going somewhere?
I was just going over to tell Mother not to wait up for me tonight.
I didn't know that was still being done, even in Brooklyn.
Hello, Mortimer.
Hello, Aunt Abby.
How are you, dear?
All right. You look well. You haven't changed much since yesterday.
Oh, my goodness. It was yesterday, wasn't it? We're seeing a great deal of you lately. Well, come. Sit down. Sit down.
Abby, don't we have something to do in the kitchen?
Huh?
You know, tea things.
The tea things. Oh, the tea things. Well, we'll just leave you two alone. You just make yourselves at home. Just
make yourselves at home.
Well, can't you take a hint?
No, that was very obvious. A lack of inventiveness, I should say.
Yes, that's exactly what you'd say.
Where do you want to go for dinner?
I don't care. I'm not very hungry.
Well, I just had breakfast. Suppose we wait until after the show.
But that'll make it pretty late, won't it?
Not with the little stink of the wear-sink tonight. From what I've heard about it, we'll be at Blake's by 10 o'clock.
You ought to be fair to these plays.
Are these plays fair to me?
I've never seen you walk out on a musical.
That musical isn't opening tonight.
No.
Darling, you'll have to learn the rules. With a musical, there are always 4 changes of title and 3 postponements. They liked it in New Haven, but it needs a lot of work.
Oh, I was hoping it was a musical.
You have such a light mind.
Not a bit. Musicals somehow have a humanizing effect on you. After a serious play, we join the proletariat in the subway, and I listen to a lecture on the drama. After a musical, you bring me home in a taxi, and you make a few passes.
Now, wait a minute, darling. That's a very inaccurate piece of reporting.
I will admit that after the Berman play, you told me I had an authentic beauty, and that's a hell of a thing to say to a girl. It wasn't until after our first musical you told me I had nice legs, and I have, too.
For a minister's daughter, you know a lot about life. Where'd you learn it?
In the choir lot.
I'll have to explain that to you sometime, darling. The close connection between eroticism and religion.
Religion never gets as high as the choir loft. Which reminds me, I'd better run over and tell Mother not to wait up for me tonight.
I've never been able to rationalize it.
What?
My falling in love with a girl who lives in Brooklyn.
Falling in love? You're not stooping to the articulate, are you?
The only way for me to regain my self-respect is to keep you in New York.
Did you say keep?
Oh, no. I have come to the conclusion that you are holding out for the legalities.
I can afford to be a good girl for quite a few years yet.
And I can't wait that long. Could we be married in a hurry, say tonight?
I'm afraid Mother will insist on officiating.
God! I'll bet your mother can make even the marriage service sound pedestrian.
Are you by any chance writing a review of it?
Forgive me, darling. It's an occupational disease. I may give that play tonight a good notice.
I really must speak to Mother.
Be sure and tell your mother not to wait up for you tonight.
I think I'd better tell her to wait up.
I'll telephone Winchell and publish the bands.
Nevertheless.
All right, everything formal and legal, but not later than next month.
Darling, I'll talk it over with Mother and set the date.
No. We'll have to see what's in rehearsal first. There'll be a lot of other first nights.
Hey there, Boltzmann.
How are you, Mr. President?
Oh, bowling, just bowling. What news have you brought me?
Just this, Mr. President. The country is squarely behind you.
I know. Wonderful, isn't it? Well, goodbye. Goodbye.
Where are you off to, Teddy?
Panama!
Panama's the cellar. He digs locks for the canal.
You're so sweet with him. And he's very fond of you.
Well, Teddy was always my favorite brother.
Favorite? Were there more of you?
There is another brother, Jonathan.
I've never heard of him. Your aunt's never mentioned him.
No, we don't like to talk much about Jonathan. He left Brooklyn very early, by request. Jonathan was the kind of boy who would like to cut worms into with his teeth.
What became of him?
I don't know. He'd wanted to be a surgeon like Grandfather was, but, well, he wouldn't go to medical school first, and his practice got him into trouble.
Oh, aren't you two going to be late for the theater?
Well, we're skipping dinner. We won't be starting for half an hour.
Oh, well then, I'll just leave you two alone together. Again.
Oh, don't bother, darling. I'm going over to speak to Mother. Before I go out with you, she likes to pray over me a little. I'll be right back. I'll cut through the cemetery.
If the prayer wasn't too long, I'd have time to lead you beside the still water.
Mortimer, that's the first time I've heard you quote the Bible. We knew Elaine would be a good influence on you.
Oh, by the way, Aunt Tabby, I'm going to marry her.
What? Oh, darling! Oh, Martha! Martha, come right in here! I have the most wonderful news for you, dear. Mortimer and Elaine are going to be married!
Married? Oh, Mortimer.
Oh, we hoped it would happen just like this.
Oh, Elaine must be the happiest girl in the world.
Happy? Just look at her leaping over those gravestones. Say, what's that?
What's what, dear?
Do you see that statue there? That's a horn Dinina Carnina.
No, dear. That's Emma B. Stout ascending to heaven.
No, standing on her left ear. You see that bird? That's a red-crested swallow. I've only seen one of those before in my life.
I don't know how you can be thinking about a bird now. What with Elaine and the engagement and everything.
Well, it's a vanishing species. Thoreau was very fond of it. By the way, I left a large envelope around here last week. It was one of the chapters of my book on Thoreau. Have you seen it?
Well, if you left it here, it must be here somewhere. Oh, what are your plans? When are you going to be married? There must be something more you can tell us about Elaine.
Elaine? Oh, yes. Elaine thought it was brilliant.
What is there?
My chapter on Thoreau.
Well, when Elaine gets back, I think we ought to have a little celebration. We must drink to your happiness. Isn't there some of that Lady Baltimore cake left?
Oh, yes.
And I'll open a bottle of wine.
Oh, and to think it happened in this very room.
Where could I put that?
Well, with your fiancé sitting beside you tonight, I do hope the play will be something you can enjoy for once. It may be something romantic. What's the name of it?
Murder Will Out.
Oh, dear.
When the curtain goes up, the first thing you'll see will be a dead body. Teddy to go to that sanitarium. Happydale?
Oh, yes, it's all arranged. Dr. Harper was here today. He dropped off the papers. Here they are.
He has to sign them right away.
That's what Dr. Harper thinks. And that way there won't be any legal difficulties after we pass law.
He's got to sign them this minute. He's down in the cellar. Get him up here right away.
There's no such hurry as that.
No. When Teddy starts working on the canal, you can't get his mind on anything else.
Look, Teddy has to go to Happydale now. Tonight!
Mortimer, how can you say such a thing? Why, as long as we live, we'll never be separated from Teddy.
Right away, I tell you, right away!
What's gotten into you? How can you say such a thing about Teddy, your own brother?
Listen, darlings. I'm frightfully sorry about this, but I've got some shocking news for you. Now, look, we all try and keep our heads. You know, we've all sort of humored Teddy. We thought he was harmless.
He is harmless.
He was harmless. That's why he has to go to Happydale now, why he has to be confined.
How can you say such a thing? What's gotten into you?
Look, Teddy's killed a man!
Nonsense, dear.
There's a body in the window seat!
Yes, we know.
You know?
Yes, dear. That has nothing to do with Teddy. Now, just forget about it. Forget you saw the man.
Forget?!
Why, we never dreamed you'd pee.
Who is he?
His name is Hoskins. Adam Hoskins. That's really all I know about him. except that he's a Methodist.
Oh, that's all you know about him? What's he doing here? What happened to him?
Oh, he died.
Aunt Martha, men don't just climb in their window seats and die!
No, he died first.
Well, how?
Oh, Mortimer, don't be so inquisitive. The gentleman died because he drank some wine with poison in it.
How did the poison get in the wine?
Well, we put it in the wine because it's less noticeable. In the tea, it has a distinct odor.
You put it in the wine?
Yes, and I put Mr. Hoskins in the window seat because Dr. Harper was coming.
So you knew what you'd done? You didn't want Dr. Harper to see the body?
Well, not at tea. That wouldn't have been very nice. No. Oh, Mrs. Schultz called earlier today. She wants us to take Junior to the movies again.
Oh, well, we must do that tomorrow or the next day.
But we'll go where we want to go. I'm not going to see one of those scary pictures again.
Hello? City desk. Hello, Al? Yeah, it's Mark. Listen, when I left the office this morning, I told you where I was going, remember? Uh-huh. Well, where did I say exactly? Really? Well, it would take me about half an hour to get to Brooklyn. What time have you got? That's right. I must be here. And Tanya and Martha, come in here!
We'll be in a minute, dear.
Come in here now!
Why, what is it?
What are we going to do? What are we going to do?
What are we going to do about what?
There's a body in there!
Yes, Mr. Hoskins.
I can't just turn you over to the police, but what am I going to do?
Well, for one thing, dear, stop being so excited. And for pity's sake, stop worrying. We told you to forget about the whole thing.
But Mr. Hoskins...
Hoskins, dear.
Whatever his name is, you can't leave him in there.
And we don't plan to. No, Teddy's down in the cellar digging the lock now.
You mean you're going to bury him in the cellar?
Well, that's what we did with the others.
No, you can't...
Others?
The other gentleman.
When you say others, do you mean others? Is it more than one others?
I believe this makes 11.
Two!
Oh, no. 12. Are you sure, Abby? Yes, I'm quite sure. You see, when Mr. Hoskins first came in, it occurred to me that he would make just an even dozen.
Are you counting the first one?
Yes, I was counting the first one. You see, that makes 12.
I don't think you can count the first one.
Oh, well, let's see.
Hello? Hello, Al? Oh, hello, Al.
They're all down in the cellar.
Shh! What? Oh, no, Al, I'm sober as a lark. I only called you because I was feeling a little pirandella. Pirin, you wouldn't know, Al. Look, I'm glad you called. Get hold of George right away. He's got to review the play tonight. I can't make it. Nope. No, Al, you're wrong. Look, George has got to cover the play tonight. Tell you all about it tomorrow. You get a hold of George. Now, let's see, where were we? 12!
Yes, you see, I really think we should count the first one. That makes 12.
All right. Now, who was the first one?
Mr. Midgley. He was a Baptist. It was right after you moved to New York. And it seems such a shame for such a lovely room to be going to waste when there were so many who needed it.
He was such a lonely old man.
All his kin and kin were dead, and it left him so forlorn and unhappy. And then when his heart attack came, and he sat there dead in that chair.
What?
Remember, Martha, looking so peaceful. We made up our minds, then and there, that if we could help other lonely old men come to that same peace, we would.
Drop dead right in that chair? How awful for you.
Why, it was quite like old times. Grandfather always had a cadaver or two lying around the house. But when Teddy came down, he thought it was a yellow fever victim.
Oh, that meant he had to be buried immediately.
So we all took him down to Panama and buried him in a log.
And that's how all this started. That meant walking in here and dropping dead.
Of course, we knew we couldn't just depend on that happening again. So,
you know all those poison jars on the shelves of Grandfather's old laboratory.
And you know your Aunt Martha's knack for mixing things. You've eaten enough of her piccalilli.
Well, for a gallon of elderberry wine, we add a teaspoonful of arsenic, a half teaspoonful of strychnine, and just a pinch of cyanide.
Should have, quite a kick.
Oh, yes. As a matter of fact, one of our gentlemen found just enough time to say, "How delicious." Now that's why we told you not to worry about it, dear. We know what's to be done. And I do think Martha and I have a right to our own little secrets.
And don't tell Elaine.
Oh, you still have to wait for her, don't you, dear? How happy you must be. Well, we'll just leave you alone with your thoughts.
Mortimer.
What? Oh, it's you.
Don't be cross, darling. Mother could see that I was excited, so I told her about us, and, well, that made it hard to get away. But listen, darling. She's not going to wait up for me tonight.
You run about a little late, and I'll call you up tomorrow.
Tomorrow?
I always call you every day or two, you know this.
But we're going to the theater tonight.
No, we're not.
Why not?
Look, Elaine, something's come up.
What, darling? Mortimer, you've lost your job?
No, darling, I haven't lost my job. I'm just not covering that play tonight, so you run along home, Elaine.
But I've got to know what's happened. Certainly you can tell me.
No, dear, I can't.
But if we're going to be married...
Married?
Have you forgotten that not 15 minutes ago you proposed to me?
I did? Yes, darling, of course, darling. Look, as far as I know, that's still on. So, you just throw along home, Elaine.
You can't throw me out of the house 1 minute and right after proposing to me, that's just...
No, darling, I'm not throwing you out of the house. Will you get out of here?
No, I won't get out of here. Not until I know what's happened.
Elaine! Don't sit on that.
I won't.
Hello? Hello, Al. Give me 1 minute, will you? All right, it's important. Just hold on! Look, Elaine, you're a sweet girl and I do love you, but I have something on my mind right now. I want you to go home and wait for me to call you.
Don't try to be masterful!
When we're married and I have problems to face, I hope you're less tedious and uninspired!
And when we're married, if we're married, I hope I find you adequate!
Elaine, darling, please come back! Hello, Al, hello? Hello, Al? Hello, it's Mort.
That's the doorbell, dear, not the telephone. Hello, please come in.
I understand you have a room to rent?
Yes, do step in.
Are you the lady of the house?
Yes, Miss Brewster. And this is my sister, another Miss Brewster.
My name's Gibbs.
Pleased to meet you. Please come sit down. I'm sorry, we were just setting the table for dinner.
Hello? Let me talk to Al again. City desk? Al! City desk! What? I'm sorry, wrong number.
Do you guys see the room?
It's upstairs. Why don't you sit down and let's get acquainted?
That won't do much good if I don't like the room.
Hello, city desk.
Do you go to church? There's a nice Episcopal church just right next door.
Hello, Al? It's Mort. We got cut off. Look, Al, I can't cover the plate tonight. That's all there is to it. I can't.
I'm Presbyterian. Used to be.
Oh. Is Brooklyn your home?
Haven't got a home. Live in a hotel. Don't like it.
What's George doing in Bermuda?
Are you?
Well, of course I told him to go to Bermuda. It's my department, isn't it?
Is there always this much noise?
Oh, he doesn't live with us.
But you've got to get somebody. Look, Al, how about the office boy? You know, the bright one. The one we don't like. You look around, I'll hold on.
I'd really like to see the room.
Well, let's just sit down. Oh, why don't you just get acquainted? Are your family Brooklyn people?
Haven't got a family.
All alone in the world?
Yep.
Well, Martha, you've certainly come to the right house.
Look, Al, there must be some printers around, at least. Look, Al, the fellow who sets my copy, all right? His name is Joe. He's the third machine from the left. You should know about what I'd write, right?
Won't you try a glass of our wine?
Never touch it.
Oh, but this is elderberry wine. We make it ourselves.
Elderberry wine? Haven't had elderberry wine since I was a boy. Thank you.
No, I'm not drinking, but I'm going to start now.
Do you have your own elderberry bushes?
No, but the cemetery's full of them.
Do you serve meals?
We might, but first see if you like our
wine.
No. Oh, Mortimer, don't drink that!
Ah! Get out of here! Do you want to be poisoned? Do you want to be killed? Do you want to be murdered?
Well, now you've spoiled everything!
You can't do things like that! I don't know how else to explain this to you, but it's not only against the law, it's wrong! It's not a nice thing to do! People wouldn't understand. He wouldn't understand.
We shouldn't have told Mortimer.
What I mean is, well, quite frankly, aunties, this has developed into a very bad habit.
Mortimer, we don't try to stop you from doing the things you like to do. I don't see why you should interfere with us.
Hello? Fine, Al. I'll see the first act and I'll pan the hell out. But look, you've got to do one thing for me. Get a hold of Daniel O'Brien, the head of our legal department. And meet me there at the theater, all right? Don't let me down. All right, we're starting now. I'm sorry about this, aunties, but I have to go to the theater and I can't get out of it. But before I go, I'd like for you both to promise me something.
We'd have to know what it is first.
I love you both very, very much. I know that you love me. You know I'd do anything in the world for you, and I want you to do just this one little thing for me.
What do you want us to do?
Don't do anything. I mean, don't do anything. Don't let anybody in this house. Leave Mr. Hoskins right where he is.
But why?
I want time to think. And I've got quite a lot to think about. You know I wouldn't want anything to happen to you.
Why, what on earth could happen to us?
You'll do this for me, won't you?
Well, we were planning on holding services.
Services?
Of course! You don't think you would bury a Methodist without a full Methodist service, do you?
Can't that wait until I get back?
Oh, then you could join us!
Yes! Yes!
Oh, Mortimer! You really would love the services, especially the hymns. Oh, Martha, remember how beautifully Mortimer used to sing in the choir before his voice changed?
Oh, yes.
And remember, you're not going to let anybody in this house. It's a promise.
Well, oh, Martha, we can do this one thing for him, now that he's cooperating with us. Well, all right, Mortimer.
Thank you. Have you got some paper? There's a man I have to see.
Let's see. Here's some stationery. Will this do?
This is perfect. I can save time for a review on the way to the theater.
Mortimer didn't seem quite himself today. Yes, but I think I can understand why.
Do tell.
Well, he's just become engaged to be married. I suppose that always makes a man nervous.
Well, their honeymoon ought to give Mortimer some real rest. I don't think he got any this summer.
Well, at least he didn't go kiting off to China or Spain.
I can never understand why he wanted to go there.
Well, I think to Mortimer, the theater has always seemed pretty small potatoes. He needs something big to criticize. Something like the human race.
Oh, of course.
Howdy, if Mortimer is going to join us for services, we'll need another hymnal. I have one in my room. You know, dear, it's really my turn to read the services. But since you weren't here when Mr. Hoskins first came in, I want you to do it.
Are you sure?
Oh, it's only fair.
I think I'll wear Mother's old brooch.
Oh, I'll get it, dear. We promised Mortimer. Well, who do you suppose it is?
I'll look out the window to see. There's two men. I don't think I recognize them.
Are you sure?
There's a car at the curb. They must have come in that.
Let me look. They're strangers to me.
Well, we'll just have to pretend like we're not at home.
Come in, Doctor. This is the home of my youth. As a boy, I couldn't wait to escape from this place. But now, I'm glad to escape back into it.
Yeah, Charlie, it's a fine hideout.
The old family must still live here. There's something so unmistakably Brewster about the Brewsters. I hope there's a fatted calf waiting to return at the prodigal.
Yeah, I'm hungry. Look, Charlie, drinks!
As though we were expected. A good omen.
Who are you? What are you doing here?
Why, Aunt Abby, Aunt Martha, it's Jonathan.
Oh, no, you're not. You're not our nephew, Jonathan. Get out of here.
But I am Jonathan.
You are nothing like Jonathan. Don't pretend you are. You just get out of here.
I am Jonathan. And this is Dr. Einstein.
And that's not Dr. Einstein either.
Not Dr. Albert Einstein. Dr. Herman Einstein.
You two just get out of here. Get out of our home.
I see you're still wearing the lovely garnet ring that Grandmother Brewster bought in England. And you, Aunt Martha, still the high collar to hide the scars where Grandfather's acid burned you.
His voice is like Jonathan's. Well, Jonathan, have you been in an accident?
No. My face. Dr. Einstein is responsible for that. He's a plastic surgeon. He changes people's faces.
But I've seen that face. Remember when we took the little Schultz kids to the movies? It was that face that scared me so much.
Easy, Charlie, easy. Don't worry, ladies. The past 5 years I've gave Charlie three new faces. I'll give him another one by today. This last face, well, I saw that picture too right before I operated. I was intoxicated.
You see, Doctor, you see what you've done to me? Even my own family.
Johnny, Johnny, your home is this lovely house. How often he tells me about Brooklyn, this house, and his aunts who love him so. Say no, it's you, Johnny. Speak to him, tell him so.
Well, Jonathan, it's been a long time. Where have you been all these years?
Oh, England. South Africa, Australia. These last 5 years, Chicago. Dr. Einstein and I were in business there together.
We were in Chicago for the World's Fair.
We found it awfully warm.
Yeah, it got hot for us too.
Well, it's wonderful to be in Brooklyn again. And you, Aunt Abby, Aunt Martha, you don't look a day older. Just as I remember you, sweet, charming, hospitable. And dear Teddy, did Did he ever get into politics? My brother, Dr. Einstein, was determined to become president.
Oh, Teddy's fine, just fine. And Mortimer as well, too.
I know about Mortimer. I see his picture at the head of his column. He's evidently fulfilled all the promise of his early nasty nature.
We're very fond of Mortimer. Well, Martha, we mustn't let what's on the stove boil over. It was nice seeing you again, Jonathan. It was nice seeing you, Jonathan. Well, Johnny, where do we go from here? We have to sink fast. The police, they have pictures of that face. I must operate on you right away. We have to find a place for that. We must also find a place for Mr. Spinalzo, too.
Don't waste any worry on that rat.
But Charlie, we have hot stiff on our hands.
Forget Mr. Spinalzo.
But you can't just leave a dead body in the bunk, see? You should have killed him, Charlie. He was a nice man who gives us a lift up, and what happens?
He said I look like Boris Karloff. That's your word, Doctor. You did that to me.
Look, Charlie, I'm tired. I'll operate on you tomorrow.
Tonight.
Now, Charlie, I'll fix you up beautiful.
And if you don't...
Jonathan... We really do appreciate you coming all the way to Brooklyn just to come and say hello. But you were never happy in this house. And we were never happy while you were in it. So we've just come in to say goodbye.
Aunt Abby, I can't say that your feelings towards me come as a surprise. I've spent a great many hours regretting the many heartaches I must have given you as a boy.
You were quite the trial to us, Jonathan.
But my great disappointment is for Dr. Einstein. You see, I promised him that no matter how rushed we were in passing through Brooklyn, I would take the time to bring him here for one of Aunt Martha's home-cooked dinners.
Oh, I'm sorry, I'm afraid there wouldn't be enough. Well, it's a pretty good-sized pot roast.
Pot roast?
Martha, I really don't think that we can just...
The least we can do...
Bless you, Aunt Martha. We'll stay to dinner.
Then we'd better hurry it along. Oh, Jonathan, if you'd like to freshen up, you can use the washroom in Grandfather's old laboratory.
Is that still there?
Oh, yes, just as he left it.
Well, if you get a meal anyway.
Grandfather's laboratory, Doctor. The perfect operating room.
Too bad we can't use it.
When you finish with me, why, we can make a fortune here.
Why hurt yourself up, Charlie? Anyway, for Brooklyn, I think we are here too late.
You don't know this town, Doctor. Practically everybody in Brooklyn needs a new face.
But your aunts, they don't want us here.
We're here for dinner, aren't we?
Yeah, but after dinner?
Leave it to me, Doctor. This house will be our headquarters for years.
Oh, that would be beautiful. This nice, quiet house. Those aunts of yours, what sweet ladies. I'll get the bands, yeah?
Doctor, we must wait until we've been invited.
But you just said...
We'll be invited.
And if they say no?
Doctor... Two helpless old women.
Like comes a beautiful dream come true, only I hope you're not dreaming. It's so peaceful.
That's what makes this house so perfect for us. It's so peaceful. Those 5 years in Chicago were among the busiest and happiest of my life.
And from Chicago, we go to South Bend, Indiana.
They wouldn't be interested in our experience in Indiana.
Well, Jonathan, you've led a very interesting life, I'm sure. But I'm afraid we shouldn't have allowed you to talk so late.
My meeting Dr. Einstein in London, I might say, changed the whole course of my life. You remember I had been in South Africa, in the diamond business, and then Amsterdam, the diamond market. I wanted to go back to South Africa, and Dr. Einstein made that possible for me.
A good job, Charlie. When we take off the bandages, his face looks so different. The nurse had to introduce me.
I love that face. I still carry the picture with me.
Yes, this looks more the way you used to look. But still, I don't know you.
I think we'll go back to that face now, Doctor.
Yeah, it's safe now. Well, John, it's getting rather late. And
I found it! I did find it!
What did you find,
Kitty? The story of my life, my biography. Here is the picture I was telling you about General President Roosevelt and General Goebbels and Kluber Katz. That's me, General, and that's you.
My, how I've changed.
Well, you see, the picture hasn't been taken yet. We haven't even started working on Kluber Katz. We're still digging locks. And now, General, you will come with me to Panama and inspect a new lock.
Oh, no, Teddy, not to Panama. Yeah, we go some other time. Panama is a long way off.
Nonsense, it's just down in the cellar.
The cellar?
Yes, we let Teddy dig the Panama Canal in the cellar.
General Goebbels, as President of the United States, Commander-in-Chief of the Army and Navy, gave you this job, I demand that you accompany me on the inspection of the new lock.
Teddy, I think it's time that you went to bed.
I beg your pardon? Who are you?
I'm Woodrow Wilson. Go to bed.
No, you're not Wilson. But your face is familiar. Let me see. You're not anyone I know now. Perhaps later, yes. On my hunting trip to Africa, you look like someone I might meet in the jungle.
Mm-hmm. No, Teddy, you see, this is your brother, Jonathan.
He's had his face changed.
Oh, so that's it. A nature faker.
And perhaps you had better get to bed, Teddy. Jonathan and his friend are just getting back to their hotel.
General Goebbels, inspect the canal.
All right, Mr. President. We go to Panama.
Oh, Burley, just pull it. Come with me, General. It's down south, you know.
Bon voyage.
Aunt Abby, I must correct your misapprehension. You spoke of a hotel. We have no hotel. We came directly here.
There's a nice little hotel just 3 blocks
Aunt Martha, this is my home.
But Jonathan, you can't stay here. We need our rooms.
You need them?
For our lodgers.
Are there lodgers in this house?
Well, not at the moment, but we plan to have some.
Then my old room is still free.
But Jonathan, there's no place for Dr. Einstein.
He'll share the room with me.
No, Jonathan, I'm afraid you can't stay here.
Dr. Einstein and I need a place to sleep. You remembered this afternoon that as a boy I could be disagreeable. It wouldn't be very pleasant for...
Perhaps we should let them stay the night.
That's settled. Please get my room ready immediately.
It only needs airing out.
Yes, we keep it ready to show our lodgers. I'm sure you and Dr. Einstein will find it quite comfortable.
You have a most distinguished guest in Dr. Einstein. I'm afraid you don't appreciate his skill, but you will. In a few weeks, you'll see me looking like a very different Jonathan.
He can't operate on you here.
When Dr. Einstein and I get organized, when we resume practice. Oh, I forgot to tell you. We're turning Grandfather's laboratory into an operating room. We expect to be quite busy.
Jonathan, we will not let you turn this house into a hospital.
A hospital? Heavens, no. It will be a beauty parlor.
Johnny, down the cell.
Doctor, my dear aunts have invited us to live with them.
Oh, you fixed it. Well, you're staying here for tonight.
Please get our room ready immediately.
Well, for tonight. Charlie, down the cellar. What do you think I found?
What?
The Panama Canal.
The Panama Canal.
It's a whole teddy dug. It just fits Mr. Spinoza. 6 feet long, 4 feet wide.
Down there?
You think that they knew we're bringing Mr. Spinoza along. Now that's hospitality.
Rather a good joke on my aunts. They're living in a house with a body buried in the cellar.
How did we get them in?
You're right. We can't just bring him into the front door. We'll drive the car between the house and the cemetery. And when they've gone to bed, we'll bring Mr. Spinoza in through the window.
Bed, just think, we have a bed tonight.
Easy, Doctor. Remember, you're operating tomorrow.
Yes, I am operating tomorrow.
This time, you had better be sober.
I'll fix you up beautiful.
And if you don't...
Jonathan, your room is ready. You can go right up.
You two run along to bed. We're driving the car up behind the house.
It's fine where it is until morning.
I don't want to leave it in the street. It might be against the law.
What are we going to do? Well, we're not going to let them stay more than one night in this house, for one thing. What would the neighbors think? People coming in here with one face and going out with another.
What are we going to do about Mr. Hoskins?
Oh, Mr. Hoskins, that's right. Oh, he's been so patient, the poor dear. And it can't be very comfortable for him in there. Well, I think we had better have Teddy come up and get Mr. Hoskins right away.
I haven't even seen him.
Oh, that's right. Well, I'll show him to you later, dear. I do hope that Teddy can come up soon and get him right away. It's...
General Gophers was very pleased. He says the canal is just the right size.
Teddy, I'm afraid there's been another yellow fever victim.
Dear me. This will be a shock to the general.
Then we shouldn't tell him about it.
But it's his department.
No, Teddy, it would just spoil his visit.
I'm sorry, Aunt Abby, it's out of my hands. Army regulations, no?
No, Teddy, you don't understand. You see, we must keep it a secret.
A state secret?
Yes, a state secret. Promise.
Oh, you have the word of the President of the United States. Cross my heart, hope to die. Anyways, how are we going to keep this a secret?
Well, you go downstairs, and when I come up here and turn out all the lights, when it's all dark, you go down and take Mr. Hoskins to Panama. Now go along, Teddy.
You may announce the President will say a few words at the service. Where is the poor devil?
He's in the window seat.
That seems to be spreading. You've never had yellow fever there before.
Well, when Dr. Einstein and Jonathan get back, let's see if we can get them to go to bed right away.
Yes, and by the time they're asleep, we'll be dressed and ready for services.
Now that everything's all settled, I think I'd better show you Mr. Hoskins.
Of course.
You know, he's really quite nice looking, considering he's a Methodist.
Oh, we're bringing the luggage in through here.
Jonathan! Oh, you startled me. Your room is waiting for you. You can go right up.
I'm afraid we don't keep Brooklyn hours, but you two run along to bed.
Now, you must be very tired, both of you, and we don't go to bed this early.
Well, you should. It's time I came home to take care of you.
But, Jonathan, we don't go to bed this early.
Aunt Martha, did you hear me say go to bed?
Yes.
The bats can go to the room in the morning. Run along, Aunt Martha. Another flight, Doctor. All right, Aunt Abby.
I'll wait until you're up, and then turn out the lights.
Aunt Abby.
I'll be right up.
Now, Aunt Abby, turn out the lights. Get the window open. You go around and hand him through.
No, he's too heavy for me. You push and I'll pull.
All right, I'm going to take a look around the house. When I tap on the window frame, you open the window.
lost the shoe somewhere. No. That was me, Charlie. I slipped.
Be more careful.
To Panama. Charlie, the door. Go quick. Our man is here. Go quick.
Moment for a social call.
I think you'd better explain what you're doing here.
We happen to live here.
You don't live here. I'm in this house every day and I've never seen you before. Where are Miss Abby and Miss Martha? What have you done with them?
Perhaps we had better introduce ourselves. This is Dr. Einstein.
Dr. Einstein?
A surgeon of great distinction and something of a magician.
And I suppose you're going to tell me your boys
are... I'm Jonathan Brewster.
Oh, you're Jonathan.
I see you've heard of me.
Yes, just this afternoon for the first time.
And what did they say about me?
Only that there was another brother named Jonathan. That's all that was said. Well, now that I know who you are, that explains everything. And I'll be running along if you'll kindly unlock the door.
That explains everything? Just what did you mean by that? Why did you come here at this time of night?
I thought I saw someone prowling around the house. I suppose it was you.
You thought you saw someone prowling around the house?
Yes. Weren't you outside? Isn't that your car?
You saw someone at the car?
Yes.
What else did you see?
Just someone walking around the house to the car, that's all.
What else did you see?
Just that's all. That's why I came over here. I wanted to tell Miss Abby to call the police, but if that was you and it's your car, then I don't need to be running along.
What was the man doing at the car?
I don't know. You see, I was on my way over here and...
I think you're lying.
I think she tells the truth, Charlie. We should let her go.
I think she's lying.
Take your hands off me!
It's going to be a private funeral.
Teddy! Teddy, tell his men who I am!
No, that's my daughter, Alice.
No, Teddy! Teddy!
Doctor, your handkerchief.
Teddy!
Shut up!
Let's take her down to the cellar.
What's happening? What's going on down there?
We've caught a burglar, a sneak thief. Go back to your room.
We'll call the police.
Go back to your room. We've called the police.
Mortimer, where have you been?
To the Nora Bay's Theater. I should have known better.
My God, I'm still there.
It's your brother Jonathan, dear. And this is Dr. Einstein.
No, I'm not having a nightmare, but what is this?
My dear Mortimer, I've come back home.
Who did you say this was?
It's your brother, Jonathan. He's had his face changed. Dr. Einstein performed the operation.
Jonathan, you always wore a horror, but you have to look like one?
Easy, Charlie, easy.
Mortimer, do you remember the things I used to do to you when we were boys? Remember the time you were tied to the bedpost? Needles under your fingernails?
Yes, I remember. I remember you as the most vicious, venomous, detestable form of animal life I ever knew.
And now don't you two boys start quarreling again the minute you've seen each other.
There won't be any quarreling, Aunt Abby. Jonathan, you are not wanted here. Get out!
We've been invited to stay.
Not in this house.
Well, just for tonight.
I don't want you anywhere near me.
Oh, but we did invite them here for tonight, and it wouldn't be very nice to go back on our word.
All right, tonight. But first thing in the morning, you're out. Where are they sleeping?
We put them in Jonathan's old room.
That's my old room. I'm sleeping in that room. I'm here to stay.
Oh, Mortimer, I'm so glad.
Charlie, we should sleep down here.
You bet you like to sleep down here.
I'll sleep on the couch and you sleep on the window seat.
The window seat! Well, you know, gentlemen, let's not argue about this. I think that the window seat's good enough for me for tonight. Yes, I'll sleep on the window seat.
Oh, this argument reminds me of Mr. Spinoza.
Spinoza? Well, now, Mortimer, it really isn't necessary to inconvenience yourself like this. You can take the room and we'll sleep down here.
Jonathan, your sudden consideration for me is very unconvincing.
Charlie, let's get packed.
Don't bother, Doctor.
Doctor, I've suddenly lost track of Mr. Spinoza.
Who is this Mr. Spinoza?
Oh, just a friend Charlie's been looking for.
Don't bring anyone else in here.
Charlie, come up and I'll tell you all about it.
Now, boys, there's no need to make trouble like this. I can just go in with Martha and you can take my room.
No trouble at all, Aunt Abby. We'll be packed in a few minutes. Then you can have the room, Mortimer.
You're just wasting your time! I told you I'm sleeping down here!
Mortimer!
What's the matter with you, dear?
I've almost been killed!
I've almost been. And Martha!
No, it was Jonathan.
He mistook her for a sneak thief.
No, it was more than that. He's some kind of maniac. Mortimer, I'm afraid of him.
Darling, you're trembling. Have you got any smelling salts?
No, but do you think some hot tea or coffee would
help? Coffee. Make some for me, too. And some sandwiches. I never got any dinner.
Yes, of course.
You weren't going out somewhere, were you? Do you know what time it is? It's after 12. 12! Look, Elaine, you've got to go home.
What? But you said you wanted some sandwiches for you both. It won't take but a minute.
Remember, we wanted to celebrate your engagement. And that's what we'll do. We'll make you two a nice supper, and we'll open a bottle of wine.
All right. No wine!
Mortimer, what's going on in this house?
What do you mean, what's going on in this house?
You were supposed to take me to dinner in the theater tonight. You called it off.
No.
You asked me to marry you.
I said I would.
And not 5 minutes later, you threw me out of the house.
Look.
Tonight, just after your brother tries to strangle me, you want to chase me home.
Listen.
Now listen, Mr. Brewster. Before I go home, I want to know where I stand. Do you love me?
I love you very, very much, Elaine. In fact, I love you so much that I can't marry you.
Have you suddenly gone crazy?
I don't think so, but it's only a matter of time. You see, darling, insanity runs in my family. It practically gallops. That's why I can't marry you, dear.
Wait a minute, you've got to do better than that.
No, dear, there's a strange taint in the Brewster blood. If you really knew my family, it's... Well, it's what you would expect if Strindberg had written Alice on Pop-Man.
Just because Teddy is a little...
No, it goes way back. The first Brewster, the one who came to America on the Mayflower. You know in those days the Indians used to scout the settlers? He used to scout the Indians!
Oh, Mortimer, that's ancient history.
No, the whole family. Take my grandfather. He tried his patent medicines out on dead people to be sure that he wouldn't kill them.
He wasn't so crazy. He made $1 million.
And then there's Jonathan. You just said he was a maniac. He tried to kill you.
But he's your brother, not you. I'm in love with you.
And then there's Teddy. You know Teddy. He thinks he's President Roosevelt. No, dear. No Brewster should ever marry. I realize now that if I'd met my father in time, I'd have stopped him.
Darling, all this doesn't prove you're crazy. Well, just look at your aunts. They're Brewsters, aren't they? And the sanest, sweetest people I've ever known.
Well, even they have their peculiarities.
Yes. What lovely peculiarities. Kindness, generosity, human sympathy.
There's another one!
Mortimer, there are plenty of others. You can't tell me anything about your aunts.
I'm not going to. Look, Elaine, you've got to go home. Something very important has just come up.
Up? From where? We're alone here together.
I know I'm acting irrationally, but just put it up to the fact that I'm a mad Brewster.
If you think you're going to get out of this by pretending you're crazy, well, you're insane! Maybe you're not going to marry me, but I'm going to marry you. I love you, you dope!
Well, if you love me, will you get the hell out of here?
Well, at least take me home, won't you? I'm afraid.
You're afraid of a little walk through the cemetery?
Mortimer, will you kiss me goodnight?
Of course, dear.
Good night, dear. Call you up in a day or two.
You critic! What the...
And Tabby and Martha, come in here!
Yes, dear, what is it? What's the name?
I thought that you promised me not to put anyone in this house while I was out.
Well, Jonathan just walked.
I don't mean Jonathan.
And Dr. Einstein came.
And I don't mean Dr. Einstein. Tell me, Aunt Abby, who is this in the window seat?
We told you, Mr. Hoskins.
Oh, it is not Mr. Hoskins.
Well, who can that be?
I'm sorry, are you trying to tell me you've never seen this man before?
I certainly am. Why, this is a fine how-do-you-do. It's getting so that anybody thinks he can just walk into this house.
Don't you try and get out of this, Aunt Abby. That's another one of your gentlemen.
Why, Mortimer, how can you say such a thing? That man is an imposter, and if he came here to be buried in our cellar, he's mistaken.
Aunt Abby, you admitted to me that you put Mr. Hoskins in the window seat.
Yes, I did.
Well, this man couldn't have just gotten the idea from Mr. Hoskins. Now could he have? By the way, where is Mr. Hoskins?
Oh, he must have gone to Panama.
You buried him already?
Well, not yet. We haven't had a minute, but with Jonathan in the house. My, we've always wanted to hold a double funeral. And I won't read services over a total stranger.
A stranger? How could I possibly believe you, Aunt Abby? There are 12 dead men in that cellar, and you admit you poisoned them.
Yes, I did. But you don't think I'd stoop to telling a fib? Martha! Martha, come in here!
Oh, Mortimer. I'd like to have a word with you.
A word is about all you'll have time for, Jonathan. I've decided that you and your doctor friend are going to have to get out of this house just as quickly as possible.
I'm glad you recognize the fact that you and I can't live under the same roof together. But you've arrived at the wrong solution. Get your suitcase and get out.
Jonathan, you're beginning to bore me. You've played your one-night stand here in Brooklyn. Move on!
Mortimer, don't think that because you've graduated from the back fence of the typewriter that you've grown up. I'm staying and you're leaving, and I mean now.
If you think I can be frightened, if you think anything I fear.
I've lived a strange life, Mortimer. But it's taught me one thing, to be afraid of nothing.
Now, Martha, you just come and see what is in the window seat.
Now, Aunt Abby!
Jonathan, let Aunt Martha see what's in the window seat. No? Aunt Abby, I owe you an apology. I have very good news for you. Jonathan is leaving. He's taking Dr. Einstein and their cold companion with him. Now, Jonathan, you're my brother. You're a Brewster. I'm going to give you one chance to get away and take the evidence with you. You can't ask for more than that. Very well. In that case, I'll have to call the police.
Don't reach for that telephone. Are you still giving me orders after seeing what's happened to Mr. Spinalzo?
Spinalzo? I knew he was a foreigner!
Remember, what happened to Mr. Spinalzo can happen to you, too.
Oh, hello, Officer O'Hara.
Hello, Miss Abby. Is there something we can do for you?
Well, I saw your lights on and thought there might be sickness in the house.
Oh, I see you got company. I'm sorry I disturbed you.
No, please, come in, officer.
Yes, do come in. We were just talking with our nephews. This is our nephew Mortimer.
Oh, pleased to meet you.
Likewise.
And this is our other nephew, Jonathan.
Pleased to make your acquaintance. Well, it must be nice having your nephews visited you. Are they going to be staying with you for a bit?
I'm staying. My brother Jonathan is just leaving.
I've met you here before, haven't I?
Oh, I'm afraid not. You see, Jonathan hasn't been home for many years.
Your face looks familiar to me. Maybe I've seen a picture of you somewheres?
I don't think so.
Yes, Jonathan. I'd be hearing a lot if I were you.
Your things are all packed anyway, aren't they?
Well, you'll be wanting to say goodbyes. I'm sorry I disturbed you.
What's the rush? I'd like for you to stick around until my brother comes.
I just dropped in to make sure everything was all right.
Well, we're going to have some coffee here in a minute. Would you care to join us?
I forgot the coffee.
And I'll make some more sandwiches. I ought to know your appetite by now, Officer O'Hara.
Don't bother. I'm due to ring in a few minutes.
You can have one cup of coffee with us, Officer O'Hara. Come, sit down. Make yourself comfortable.
Say, haven't I seen a photograph of your brother around here someplace?
I don't think so.
Well, he certainly reminds me of somebody.
Well, he looks like someone you've probably seen in the movies.
I never go to the movies. I hate them. No, my mother says the movies is the best there are.
Yes, it's full of them. Mm-hmm. Your mother said that?
Oh, yeah. My mother was an actress. A stage actress. Perhaps you heard of her. Peaches Latour?
That sounds like a name I've seen on the program. What did she play?
Well, big hit was Mutton Chef. She played it 3 years. No, I was born on tour. Third season.
You were?
Yep. Sioux City, Iowa. I was born in the dressing room at the end of the second act. And Mother made the finale.
What a trooper. I'm sure there's a very good story in your mother. You know, I write about the theater.
You do? Say, you're not Mortimer Bruce, the dramatic critic.
Yes.
Oh, well, I certainly am glad to meet you. You know, Mr. Brewster, we're in the same line of business.
We are?
Yeah, I'm a playwright. All this being on the police force is just temporary.
How long have you been on the force?
12 years. I'm collecting material for my play.
I'll bet it's a honey.
Well, it ought to be. With all the drama I see being a cop. Say, Mr. Brewster, you got no idea what goes on in Brooklyn.
I think I have.
Say, what time you got?
10 after 1.
Oh, gee, I gotta ring in.
Well, wait a minute, O'Hara! You know, on that play of yours, I may be able to help you.
You what? Oh, say, it was my fate walking in here tonight. Look, I'll tell you the plot.
Okay. Oh, are you on your way now, Jonathan? Splendid! You haven't got much time, you know.
Oh, are you leaving now, Jonathan? Goodbye. Goodbye, Dr. Einstein. Do make sure you take all your bags with you.
Yes, Jonathan. You can't leave without all of your things, you know. Well, O'Hara, it was wonderful to meet you. We'll get together soon and talk about your play.
I'm not leaving now, Mr. Brewster.
Why not?
Well, you just offered to help me with my play. We're gonna write it together.
I can't do that, O'Hara. I mean, I'm not a creative writer.
I'll do the creating, you just put the words to it.
But O'Hara...
No, Mr. Brewster, I'm not leaving this house till I tell you my story.
In that case, Mortimer will be running along.
Don't try that! You can't go yet. You have to take everything with you, you know. Look, O'Hara, why don't you get running along? My brother's just going...
I can wait. I've been waiting 12 years.
Sorry, I'm so long.
Don't bring those in here. O'Hara, would you join us for a bite in the kitchen?
The kitchen?
Jonathan's leaving.
Oh, that's nice.
Are you sure you don't mind eating in the kitchen?
Where else would you eat?
I'm glad you came back to Brooklyn, Jonathan. It gives me a chance to throw you out. And the first one out will be your boyfriend, Mr. Spinazzo.
Hey, look, Mr. Brewster. We can talk in here.
Coming right out.
I might have known you grew up to ride a play with the policeman.
Get going now, all three of you.
Doctor, this affair with my brother has got to be settled.
Come on, Charlie, let's get going. Your brother gives us a chance to get to bed. What more can you ask?
We're staying right here tonight, Doctor.
Come on, Charlie, let's get going.
Doctor, you know when I make up my mind.
Yeah, if you make up your mind, you lose your head. Brooklyn ain't a good place for you.
Doctor.
Did the cop in the kitchen and Mr. Spinazzo in the window seat?
That's all he's got on us. We'll take Mr. Spinazzo down and dump him in the bay, and then come right back here. Then if he tries to interfere.
All right, we stick together. Someday he might get stuck together. Do we take these with us?
No, take them down to the cellar. Move fast. Mr. Spinazzo can go out the same way he came in.
Johnny! Down the cellar!
What?
The hole? We have an ace in the hole. Come quick, I'll show you.
While we bury Mr. Spinazzo in the cellar.
Bury Mr. Spinazzo? In our cellar? No, no, Jonathan, you have to take him with you.
There's a friend of Mortimer's downstairs waiting for him.
A friend of Mortimer's?
He and Mr. Spinazzo will get along fine together. They're both dead.
They must mean Mr. Hoskins.
Mr. Hoskins?
You know about what's in the cellar?
Oh, yes. He's no friend of Mortimer's. He's one of our gentlemen.
Your gentlemen?
Why, yes. You cannot bury Mr. Spinazzo down in our cellar. That is final. It's too crowded down there already.
Crowded? With what?
Why, there are 12 graves down there now.
12 graves? You mean that you murdered?
Murdered? Certainly not. It's one of our charities.
Why, what we do is a mercy.
You've done that? Here in this house? And you've buried them down there?
Johnny, we've been chased all over the world. They've stayed here in Brooklyn. They're just as good as us.
What?
They have 12. We have 12.
I've got 13.
No, Johnny. We have 12.
13. There's Mr. Spinazzo, the first one in London, two in Johannesburg, one in Sydney, one in Melbourne, two in San Francisco, one in Phoenix, Arizona.
Phoenix?
The filling station.
No.
Three in Chicago, and one in South Bend. That makes 13.
No, you can't count South Bend. He died of pneumonia.
He wouldn't have gotten pneumonia if I hadn't shot him.
No, Charlie, he died of pneumonia. He don't count.
He counts with me. I say 13.
No, Charlie, if you have 12, they're just as good as us.
Oh, they are they? Well, that's easily taken care of. All I need is one more, that's all, just one more.
Well, here I am.
Thank you. that.
This is our house and this is our cellar, and you can't do that. Ladies, please, go back upstairs where you belong.
Abby, Martha, go upstairs.
You'll find out. You'll find out whose house this is.
I'm warning you, you'd better stop it. You'd better stop it right now. Hasn't Mortimer come back yet?
No.
It's a terrible thing to do, to bury a good Methodist with a foreigner. And we promised Mr. Hoskins a full Christian funeral. Where do you suppose Mortimer went?
I don't know, but he has to be doing something important, because he said to Jonathan, I'll settle this, you'll see.
Well, he can't very well settle it while he's out of the house. That's all we want settled. What's going on down there?
All right. Now, where's Teddy?
Where have you been, Mortimer?
I've been over to see Dr. Gilchrist. I have his signature on Teddy's commitment papers.
Mortimer, what is the matter with you? Running around getting papers signed at a time like this. Do you know what Jonathan is doing? He's putting Mr. Hoskins and Mr. Spinalzo in together.
Oh, he is he? Oh. Well, let him. Is Teddy in his room?
Teddy won't be any help.
Once he signs these papers, I can tackle Jonathan.
What have they got to do with it?
You had to go and tell Jonathan about those 12 graves. If I can make Teddy responsible for those, I can protect both of you, don't you see?
No, I don't see. And we pay taxes to have the police protect us.
I'll be back down in a minute.
Come, Martha. We're going for the police.
All right. The police? You can't go for the police!
And why not?
Because if you tell the police about Mr. Spinalzo, they'd find Mr. Hoskins, too. And that might make them curious. And they'd find out about your other 12 gentlemen!
Now, Mortimer, we know the police better than you do. I don't think they'd go prying into our private affairs if we asked them not to.
But if they did find your 12 gentlemen, they'd have to report to headquarters.
Oh, I don't think they'd bother. It'd be a very long report, and if there's one thing a police officer hates to do, it's to write.
You can't depend on that! It might leak out! And you couldn't expect a judge and a jury to understand.
Oh, Judge Coleman would.
Oh, yes, we know him very well. And he's coming to tea someday. He's promised. Mm-hmm. Oh, yes, we must talk to him about that. His wife recently died, and it's made him quite lonely. Come along, Martha.
No! You can't do this. I won't let you. You can't leave this house. And you can't have Judge Coleman to tea.
Well, if you're not going to do something about Mr. Spinalzo, we are.
I am going to do something. We may have to call the police in later. But if we do, I want to be ready for them.
You just get Jonathan out of this house.
And Mr. Spinalzo, too.
Will you please let me do this my own way? I've got to see Teddy.
If they're not out of this house by morning, Mortimer, we're going to call the police.
They'll be out, I promise you that. Go to bed, will you? God's sake, get out of those clothes! You look like Judith Anderson or something.
Well, if Mortimer's really going to do something about it at last, I guess that means Jonathan's going through a lot of unnecessary trouble. I'd better tell him. Oh, Jonathan, you'd better stop doing what you're doing.
It's already been done. Did I hear Mortimer?
It will just have to be undone. You're going to be out of this house by morning. Mortimer's promised.
Oh, we are we? Well, in that case, you two can run along to bed and have a pleasant night's sleep.
Yes. Come, Abby.
Good night, aunties.
Not good night, Jonathan. Goodbye. By the time you're up, you'll be out of this house. Mortimer's promised.
And he has a way of doing it, too.
Then Mortimer is back.
Oh, yes. He's just upstairs talking to Teddy.
Goodbye, Jonathan.
Goodbye, Jonathan.
Perhaps you had better say goodbye to Mortimer, too.
Oh, you'll see Mortimer.
Yes, I'll see Mortimer.
Phew, glad that's all fixed up. Smooth as a lake. Nobody will ever know that we are down there. Let's go to bed, yeah, Johnny?
You're forgetting, Doctor.
What?
My brother Mortimer.
Oh, we take care of him tomorrow or the next day.
No, Doctor, tonight, now.
No, Johnny, not tonight. I'm tired. Let's go to bed. And tomorrow I'm operating.
Yes, Doctor. Tomorrow you're operating. But tonight we take care of Mortimer.
No, Johnny, not tonight.
Doctor, look at me. You can see it's going to be done, can't you?
Yes, Johnny, I see. We do it the quick way, like in London.
No, Doctor. I think this calls for something special. I think perhaps the Melbourne method.
No, Johnny, not the Melbourne method. 2 hours and what? The guy in London was just as dead as the guy in Melbourne.
We had to work too fast in London. There was no aesthetic satisfaction. But Melbourne, that was something to remember.
Remember? I wish I did it. No, Johnny, not the Melbourne method.
Yes, Doctor, get your instruments.
No, Johnny, not me.
Where are they, Doctor?
I won't tell you, Johnny.
Oh, yes, you hid them in the cellar. Where?
I don't tell you.
I'll find them, Doctor.
Don't do that, Mr. President.
I cannot sign any proclamation without first consulting my cabinet.
Well, this must be a secret.
A secret proclamation? How unusual.
Japan mustn't know until it's signed.
Japan? Oh, I'll sign it right away. You have my word for it. I'll let the cabinet know later.
Yes, let's go and sign this.
You wait here. A secret proclamation has to be signed in secret.
But at once, Mr. President.
I'd like to put on my silent clothes.
If you go now.
No, Doctor, I'm waiting for something. Something important.
No, if you go now.
Dr. Einstein, I have nothing against you personally. You seem to be a decent fellow. Take my advice and get just as far away from here as possible.
You get out.
All right. Don't say I didn't warn you.
I'm warning you! Get away, quick!
Things are going to start popping around here any minute.
Look, Johnny's in a bad mood, and when he's like this, things happen. Terrible things.
Jonathan doesn't worry me now.
Don't those plays ever teach you something?
About what?
Well, these people in the plays have more sense than you do.
Oh, you think so, do you? You think that people in plays act intelligently. I wish you had to sit through some of the ones that I've had to sit through. Take the wonderful little masterpiece I saw tonight, for instance. Now, in this play, there's a man, our hero. He's supposed to be bright. He knows he's in a house with murderers. He ought to know that he's in danger. He's even been warned to get out of the house. But does he go? No! He stays there. Now I ask you, Doctor, is that what an intelligent person would do?
You're asking me?
He didn't even have sense enough to be frightened, to be on guard. For instance, the murderer invites him to sit down.
You mean, won't you sit down?
Believe it or not, that one was in there too.
And what did he do?
He sat down, the big dope. Now mind you, this fellow was supposed to be bright. So there he sits, just waiting for the villain to truss him up. And what do you think they use to tie him with?
What?
The curtain cord.
Well, why not? It was very convenient.
It's a little too convenient. When are playwrights going to use some imagination? The curtain cord?
He didn't see him get it, did he?
See him? He sat there with his back to him. That's the kind of stuff we have to suffer through night after night. And they say that the critics are killing the theater? No, no, it's the playwrights who are killing the theater, my sir. So there he sits, the big dope. This hero is supposed to be bright, just waiting to be trussed up and gagged.
You were right about the fellow in the play. He wasn't very bright.
Now, Mortimer, if you don't mind, we'll finish the story. I've been away 20 years, but never once in all that time were you out of my mind. I dreamed of you one night in Melbourne. When I landed in San Francisco, I felt a strange satisfaction. Once again, was I in the same country as you. Now, Doctor, we go to work.
Johnny, for me, let's do this the quick way.
No, Doctor. This must truly be an artistic achievement. After all, we're performing before a very distinguished critic.
Now, Charney, we both need a drink. I can't operate without the drink.
Pull yourself together, Doctor.
The vine, when we first came in here, where did it go? This is all that's left. We'll split it.
Wait a minute, Doctor. Where are your manners? Yes, Mortimer. I realize now it was you who brought me back to Brooklyn. Doctor, to my dear, dead brother. God! Damn that idiot! He goes next, that's all. He goes next.
No, Johnny, not Teddy. That's my stop.
We get to Teddy later.
We don't get to him at all.
We have to work fast now.
So, the Melbourne method? Or the London way?
Yes, Doctor, the quick way, like in London.
Yes! Colonel's got to quit blowing that horn.
We're taking the bugle away from him, Doctor.
Oh, it's gonna be hell to pay in the morning.
We're handling it.
We promised the neighbors we wouldn't do that anymore.
We're handling it, officer. Good night.
I better speak to him myself. Now, where are the lights? Hey! You stood me up! I waited an hour at Kelly's for you.
He was explaining the play he saw tonight, and this is what happened to the fellow in the play.
Did they have that in the play you saw tonight? Oh, gee. They practically stole that from the second act of my play.
Why, my second. Oh, yeah. I better start from the beginning.
What?
It opens in my mother's dressing room, where I was born. Only, I ain't born yet. So,
no. You gotta hear the plot.
So, she's sitting there, making up a scene, when all of a sudden, through the door, a man with a... black mustache walks in, turns to my mother.
May I?
He turns to my mother and says, Miss Latour, will you marry me? He doesn't know she's pregnant.
Door handle turn.
middle of the night. From the way the neighbors have been calling in about it, you'd think the Germans have dropped a bomb on Flatbush Avenue.
The lieutenant's on a warpath. He says the gun's gotta be put away someplace.
Yes, yes!
Well, gee, Mr. Brewster, I gotta get out of here. So I'll just go through the third act, quick.
Stay away from me!
Say, do you know what time it is? It's after 8 o'clock in the morning.
It is? Oh, gee, Mr. Brewster. Them first two acts weren't a little long. But I don't see anything we can leave out.
Leave it all out!
Who the hell is this guy?
That's my brother.
Oh, the one that ran away, so he came back.
Yes, he came back.
This is Brophy, get me, Mac. I better let him know we found him, Joe. Mac, tell the lieutenant he called the big manhunt. We got him in the Brewster house. You want us to bring him in? Oh, well, right. We'll wait here. The lieutenant's on the way over.
So, I've been turned in, eh? All right, you got me. And I bet you and that stool pigeon brother of mine are gonna split the reward.
Reward?
Now I'll do some turning in of my own. I bet you think my aunts are sweet old ladies. Well, they've got 13 bodies buried in the cellar.
Teddy! Teddy, old Teddy!
What the hell are you talking about?
You better be careful what you're saying about your aunts. They happen to be friends of ours.
I'll prove it to you. I'll show you where they're buried. 13 bodies in the cellar.
Oh, yeah?
Don't you want to see what's in the cellar?
Go on down in the cellar with them.
I'm not so sure I want to be down in the cellar with him. Look at that puss. He looks like Boris Karloff.
What the hell do you think you're doing?
What do you know about that?
Hey, come in.
What the hell are you men doing here? I told you I was going to handle this.
Well, sir, we were just about to...
Did he put up a fight?
This ain't the guy that blows the bugle. This is his brother. He tried to kill Klein.
All I said was he looked like Boris Karloff.
Turn him over.
We kind of think he's wanted somewhere.
Oh, you kind of think he's wanted somewhere? If you men don't read the circulars we hang up in the station, at least you can read True Detective. For sure he's wanted. In Indiana. Escaped from the prison of the mentally insane. He's a lifer. For God's sake, that's what they described him. Looked like Karloff.
Was there a reward mentioned?
Yeah, and I played in it.
He was trying to get us down in the cellar.
Said there were 13 bodies buried down there.
13 bodies in the cellar? And that didn't tip you off he came out of a nut house?
I thought all along he acted kind of crazy.
Oh, it's Shakespeare. Where have you been all night? And you needn't bother to tell me.
I was here writing a play.
With Mortimer Brewster? Well, you're gonna have plenty of time to write that play. You're suspended. Now get back and report it.
Well, can I at least use the station typewriter?
No! Get out of here! You men take him somewhere else and bring him too. Find out what you can about his accomplice, the man who helped him escape. He's wanted too. No wonder the police force is full of flatheads like you. Falling for story like that. 13 bodies in the cellar.
But there are 13 bodies in the cellar.
Who are you?
I'm President Roosevelt.
What the hell is this?
Oh, beauty! Good morning, Cool.
Dear me, now that you're the fever victim.
No, what?
This is a spy because of my house.
A spy? Well, if there's to be any questioning these spies, that's my department.
Keep out of this.
You forget, as president, I'm also head of the Secret Service.
Get out of here.
Captain, I'm Warner Brewster.
Are you sure?
I'd like to talk to you about my brother, Teddy, the one who blew the bugle.
There isn't going to be any talking about him. He's got to go.
Oh, I've got to agree with you. In fact, it's all been arranged for.
Where is he?
Happydale Sanitarium.
Well, I don't care where he goes as long as he goes.
Well, he's going, all right. But, well, I want you to know, everything that's happened around here, Teddy's responsible for. Now, those 13 bodies in the cellar...
Yeah, 13 bodies in the cellar. It ain't enough for them blowing that bugle and got the neighbors all afraid of it. But can you imagine what would happen if that cockeyed story about 13 bodies in the cellar got around? And now he's starting a yellow fever victim scare. It's cute, ain't it?
13 bodies? Do you think that anybody would believe that story?
Well, you never know. Some people are just dumb enough. About a year ago, a fellow over in Greenpoint decided to start a murder rumor. I had to dig up nearly half an acre lot just to prove that he didn't even kill it.
Excuse me.
Good morning, Mortimer.
Good morning, dear.
This is Mr. Witherspoon. He's come to meet Teddy.
To meet Teddy?
Mr. Witherspoon is the superintendent of Happydale.
Oh, come right in. This is Officer...
Lieutenant Rooney. Thank you. I'm glad you're here, Super, because you're taking him back today.
Today? I didn't know that.
Not today.
Look, Elaine, I've got a lot of business to attend to here, so I want you to go home. Wait for me to call you.
Nuts!
I had no idea it was this immediate.
Yes, the papers are signed and he goes today.
Complete insubordination! You men will find out I'm no mollycoddle! When the president is being treated this way, well, what's this country coming to?
There's your man, Super.
Just a minute. Mr. President, I have very good news for you. Your term of office is over.
Is this March the 4th?
Practically.
See? Oh, now I go on my hunting trip to Africa. Yes, I must bring down my equipment. Is he trying to move into the White House before I moved out?
Who, Teddy?
Taft.
This isn't Mr. Taft, Teddy. This is Mr. Witherspoon. He's to be your guide in Africa.
Oh, bully! Just bully! I'll bring down my equipment. If the safari comes, tell them to wait. Oh, goodbye, Aunt Abby. Goodbye, Martha. I'm on my way to Africa. Wonderful, isn't it? Charge!
Good morning, darlings.
We have visitors.
This is Lieutenant Rooney.
Morning, Lieutenant. My, you don't look like the fuss budget the other policemen say you are.
Now, why he's here? Well, Teddy blew his bugle again last night.
We'll speak to Teddy about that again.
I'm afraid it's a bit more serious than that, Miss Brewster.
And you have met Mr. Witherspoon. He's the superintendent of Happydale.
Hello, Mr. Witherspoon.
You've come to meet Teddy.
He's come to take him.
Auntie's the police want Teddy to go there today.
Oh, no. No, that's not until after we're gone.
I'm sorry, ladies, but the papers are signed and he's going with the superintendent.
No, we won't permit it. We promise we'll take the bugle away from him.
I'm sorry, ladies, but the law's the law. He's committed himself and he's going.
Well, if Teddy goes, then we're going too.
Yes, we'll go too.
Why not?
Well, that's sweeter than they want to, but it's impossible. You see, we can't take sane people at Happydale.
Mr. Witherspoon, if you allow us to go with Teddy, we'll leave Happydale in our will for a generous sum.
Well, the Lord knows we could use some money, but I'm afraid...
Now, let's be sensible about this. For example, here I am wasting my morning when I've got work to do. You know there are still murders to be solved in Brooklyn.
Yes! Are there?
Yes! It ain't only your nephew's bugle blowing, but I could be put through the trouble of digging up your cellar.
Our cellar?
Your nephew's been spreading around that there's 13 bodies buried down there.
Oh, but there are 13 bodies buried in our cellar.
You think that's why Teddy has to leave? Come, we'll show you the 13 bodies.
Yes, there's one, Mr. Spinazzo. He doesn't belong there. He'll have to go.
Yes.
But the other 12 are our gentlemen.
You know what? I don't think the lieutenant wants to go down to this cellar. He was telling me that only last year he had to dig up a half-acre lot. Weren't you, Lieutenant?
That's right.
Well, you wouldn't have to dig here. The graves are all marked. We put flowers on them every Sunday.
Flowers? Superintendent, don't you think you could find room for these
Lovely ladies.
Well, I
mean... We can go with Teddy. We'll sign the papers. Where are they?
He's coming around, Lieutenant.
Sign him up, Superintendent. I want to get this all cleaned up. 13 bodies.
Where do we sign?
If you'll sign right there.
And you here, Aunt Martha?
Oh, I'm really looking forward to going. The neighborhood here has changed, so...
In a front lawn again. Oh, we're overlooking something.
What?
We are going to need the signature of a doctor.
Dr. Einstein! Wonderful to see you. Could you come right over here for just 1 minute? We have some papers you'd like me to sign.
No, please, I must...
Now, doctor. You know, at one time last night, I thought the doctor was going to operate on me. Just come right over, doctor! Sign right here on the line, doctor.
Were you leaving, doctor? Oh, yes, I think I must get going now.
Aren't you going to wait for Jonathan?
I don't think we are going to the same place.
Hello, Elaine. I'm glad to see you. Stick around, huh?
Don't worry. I'm going to.
Hello, Mac. It's Rooney. We've captured that guy that's wanted in Indiana. There's a description of his accomplice on the desk. Read it to me. Thanks, Mac. About 145 pounds, 5'4", blue eyes, talks with a German accent, poses as a doctor. Thanks, Mac.
Lieutenant, the doctor here has just completed the signatures.
Thank you, doctor. You're really doing Brooklyn a great service.
Mr. Brewster?
Yes.
Now you sign here as next of kin.
Sign next of kin right here?
That's right.
Of course. And that makes everything complete, everything legal.
Oh, yes.
Well, aunties, now you're safe.
When do you think you'll be ready to start?
Oh, perhaps a few minutes. Oh, why don't you go upstairs and tell Teddy just what he can take with him?
Upstairs?
I'll show you.
Oh, no, Mortimer. We'd like to talk to you for a moment. Yes, Mr. Witherspoon, his room is just upstairs to the left. Mortimer, we want you to live here now.
No, Aunt Abby, this house is too full of memories.
But you and Elaine are going to be married. You'll need a house.
Well, darling, this is very definite.
It's nothing of the kind. We're going to be married right away. Mortimer, there's something we're really quite worried about.
Oh, you're going to love it, Happydale, darlings.
Yes, we're sure we'll be very happy there. That's just the thing. We don't want anything to go wrong.
You see, you signed as next of kin.
Well, of course, why wouldn't I?
Well, it's something we never wanted to tell you. But since you're a man, and Elaine, you should know too, you're not really a Brewster.
You see, a good many years ago, your mother came to us as a cook, and you were born about 2 months afterward. Oh, she was such a good cook and such a lovely woman. We didn't want to lose her, so Brother married her.
I'm not really a Brewster?
I hope you're not too upset about this, dear.
And Elaine, it won't make any difference to you, will it?
Elaine! Did you hear? Do you understand? I'm a bastard!
Well, I really must go see about breakfast.
Oh, don't bother. Mortimer's coming over to my house. Mother's gone to Philadelphia, so Mortimer and I are going to have breakfast together.
Yes, I need some coffee, I thought. Why didn't
I? Oh, yes, I should think you'd like to get some rest.
I would.
One moment with a spoon. Take this with you.
Are you leaving now, Jonathan? Well, goodbye.
Yes, there's some people down in Indiana that want to take care of him for the rest of his life.
Oh, well, it's such a relief to know that you have a place to go.
We're leaving too.
Yes, we're going to Happydale.
Then this is the last this house is seeing of the Brewsters.
Not if Mortimer doesn't take it.
I have a suggestion to make. Why don't you turn this property over to the church?
Why, we never thought of that.
After all, it should be part of the cemetery.
Hurry along, I'm a busy man.
Goodbye, aunties. I can't better my score, but now neither can you. At least I have that satisfaction. The score stands even, 12-12.
Come along.
Jonathan was always such a mean boy. Wouldn't let anybody get ahead of him. I just wish there was a way to show him he isn't so smart. Mr. Witherspoon, do your family live with you at Happydale?
I have no family.
Oh. Well, then, I guess you must consider everyone at Happydale your family.
I'm afraid you don't quite understand. As head of the institution, I have to keep quite aloof.
Oh, well, that must make it quite lonely for you.
It does, but my duty is my duty.
Well, Martha, please come sit down. Won't you try a glass of our elderberry wine?
Elderberry wine?
We make it ourselves, from the berries here in the cemetery.
Why, yes. Of course, a Happydale relationship will be more formal. But here, you don't see much elderberry wine nowadays. I thought I had my last glass of it.
Oh, no. Here it is.